Thank you all so much for joining. We are so thrilled to have so many of you joining for our first innovation series presentation. My name is Jessica Carson. I'm the Director of Innovation within APA's Strategy Office. And I am so pleased to introduce you to a speaker who I know will be able to offer us all some very valuable tools and perspectives to help us transform this time of great uncertainty into opportunity. And so without further ado, I'd like to introduce you all to Dr. Christian Busch. Dr. Busch teaches at New York University and the London School of Economics. At NYU, he directs the Global Economy Program of the Center for Global Affairs. Previously, he co-directed the LSE's Innovation and Co-Creation Lab and served as a course leader. He is also a co-founder of Sandbox Network, a leading community of young innovators active in over 20 countries, as well as Leaders on Purpose, an organization convening high-impact leaders. Christian is a member of the World Economic Forum's Expert Forum, a fellow of the Royal Society of Arts, and frequently speaks at conferences such as the World Economic Forum, TEDx, and Financial Times Sustainability Summit, among many, many, many other incredible things that Dr. Busch has accomplished, and I'm sure that will become quickly evident in his presentation.
Well, thank you so much for the wonderful introduction, Jessica. It's a real pleasure to be here with you all today. Thank you so much for taking the time. I'm particularly delighted to be here, given that I've always been fascinated by the question of how the mind works and how behaviors unfold. And so being in a room full of people who have dedicated their lives to it is an absolute pleasure. And I do hope that we will get to meet in real life at some point, once hairdressers and everyone else opens up again, and that we will continue the conversation far beyond this session today, which is focused on something that I've been very excited by over the last 10 years, which is the question of how do we transform uncertainty into opportunity. Being the German I am, of course, I have a very kind of structured table of content. So I'll start with a bit of context setting and then diving into the question of how does serendipity unfold in theory and practice. Then the question of how do we overcome biases that might hold us back from having serendipity, and then what are ways to cultivate serendipity that we can take into our day-to-day lives. What I've also tried to do is to really integrate a couple of closing thoughts that are based on the questions that you send in. Jessica very graciously shared them with me, and so I'll definitely dive into those as well. To give you a bit of context, this is me. I mean, not back then, but now. But this is illustrating how, when I was 18, I was one of these kind of rebellious teenagers who lived into the day and, had a relatively reckless lifestyle that I transferred into my driving style. I probably held the unofficial world record of how many dustbins you can knock out on your way to school. And then one day I wasn't so lucky anymore. Usually, it always worked out and I always got away with things. And one day that didn't work anymore, and I had a car accident that almost killed me. And it kind of opened up all these questions in terms of, if I would have been killed, was it all worth it? Did I do anything that had some kind of meaning or purpose, or that somehow mattered? And I had to answer all these questions with a very clear no. And so that put me in a kind of intense search for meaning. I started reading Viktor Frankl, which is still my bedside table book. You know how some people have their Bible next to their bed? I have my Viktor Frankl. And so I started reading Viktor Frankl and really trying to kind of dive into the question of what is something meaningful that I could do with my life. And I kind of endeavored and I went on a kind of entrepreneurial journey first, building support platforms for people to make the ideas happen. And then over time, also more and more into academia to try to understand what are underlying patterns behind what makes some people more successful than others, what brings more meaning to some people than to others, and related themes. And one of the things that I've been fascinated by is that kind of idea that I've seen with myself, which is that I found a lot of meaning in crisis, very inspired by Frankl and this idea that, that death can be life's greatest motivator because it, it makes you realize how quickly life can be over. And that in a way, our response to the stimulus that we can't influence is that kind of degree of freedom that we have. And so, you know, the question to me, as to others, was do you let yourself define by the situation, or do you try in some way to frame that situation and do something? And I feel like over the last years, I've encountered a lot of people who have inspired me a lot in terms of questioning a lot of the assumptions that I used to have around, you know, how given a reality is, how socially constructed life is, and those different types of questions that I will get back to in a second. But one thing that I found fascinating is, you know, when looking at the world, I like kind of seeing that most organizations and most structures out there seem to still be based on this very old kind of hierarchy of needs of people that probably all of you have come across multiple times, where, you know, the idea was, okay, hey, we first fulfill physiological needs, then safety needs, then social needs, then esteem needs. And then if we still have time one day, then we self-actualize, then we solve the creative problems that we are really that really give us deeper meaning. And so that's of course an extremely linear way of living. It's kind of step by step. In a way, someone like Bill Gates, for example, would first set up Microsoft, make a lot of money, and then set up a foundation and give it all back. So you first do well, then you do good, step by step by step, you're climbing up. Of course, now we have two more primary needs, Wi-Fi and battery. Which is of course at the absolute core of it. But one thing we realize is that at the end of the day, there is this kind of desire and this kind of shift across the world, across projects that we've been doing, in people to essentially try to integrate those things at the same time rather than doing them after and after, rather than going into a career in XYZ industry where you first make a lot of money and then later on go into an NGO and somehow give back. There's, especially among my students and among those people we've been doing research with, there's a deep-seated desire of combining money and meaning, of combining those different needs at the same time, and in organizations, a shift towards saying, how do we integrate profit and purpose so that people have that integration happen? And of course, that is in flux, and organizations try to understand how to do that better. But what I'm fascinated by is that question of, A, how do we get individuals to, in a way, be able to do that within the structures we are helping develop? But also, how do we help develop this enlightened self-interest? What you see here, the kind of how these circles are related to each other. That in a way, in a world where, you know, we are in a knowledge economy, where it is about sharing information, it is about sharing with others different types of experiences and other things. And the more I can cater to the circle of needs of others, the more they have a quote unquote incentive to cater to mine. And so this enlightened self-interest, we've been interested in both on the individual level, but also what it means, for example, for how we could rethink capitalism in terms of a more inclusive type of capitalism. And I'll come back to this later, but for now, the fascinating thing then of course is, does that apply across contexts? And a lot of my work has been in low-income contexts, so especially in sub-Saharan Africa, where people are living in extremely resource-constrained environments, where there's a constant fight-or-flight type of setting. And you know, the initial question, of course, that we have was, do these things really apply in those contexts? Do we really have people that can creatively solve problems or self-actualize or do other things in a setting where they first need to somehow survive? And what I'm fascinating is, so one of our studies that we've done across sub-Saharan Africa was fascinating because essentially we try to understand when you have quote unquote support organizations such as social enterprises locally that focused on low-cost education and related services such as inspiring people, giving people back hope and other means that would quote unquote try to inspire people and empower people, that traditionally organizations, especially Western organizations, would come into a context and they would focus on resources. They would say, what do you need? And so that directly puts a person into the position of a victim, right? It says, you need a resource from me, I can help you out. And so it's a very passive approach to it. And so one of the things that transpired when working over the last 10 years with organizations in that context was really to see that, hey, you know, people in that context, and this is a quote that I really liked in that respect, that people that work with organizations that had a quote unquote more enlightened approach actually turned around from saying, we are the, you know, someone who is here and is relying on these kind of support measures, to someone who can creatively solve problems. And so the quote here is the realization that we can make things happen ourselves. It's inspired. Most importantly, it gives you dignity, because now if I'm a father or a mother, I don't feel I failed if I didn't provide enough resources to my children and needed that organization, but I feel I can solve it myself. I'll later talk about some concrete practices, what they did, but the key idea here on the individual level was to really say, people, once they redefined resource constraints, so for example, old garages or a former drug dealer, away from this is someone or something that doesn't work, to, oh, okay, a old garage might be a potential training center. A former drug dealer might be an extremely creative person who can solve problems because they were really good at developing networks. They were really good at solving problems earlier. So if we can channel that into them becoming a teacher, and even if teaching just means telling their inspiring story of how they are not a drug dealer anymore, then essentially you create a whole generation of people who believe that they can create their own luck. And so, of course, there will always be structural constraints, and there will always be constraints that are, you know, there as a reality, right? Like structural constraints, societal inequality, and so. And that is, of course, something that we need to solve on a more systemic level. But then on the individual level, one of the things that I've been very inspired by is exactly that shift in mindsets, that then people felt, I can creatively solve my own problems, I am worthy of solving them, I can be a teacher. And I will not forget when I arrived there the first time in the Cape Flats in Cape Town a couple of years ago. I went into the Cape Flats, and when you're there, you can look up to the Table Mountain and you almost see, at least symbolically, the University of Cape Town. And University of Cape Town, when I asked the kids in the neighborhood there, you know, so do you aspire to go to the university? And they would always say, no, that's for the white kids. And, you know, it really stuck with me in the sense that there was this idea of, okay, there's supposed to be a certain idea of how life will transpire. And what these organizations like Reconstructed Living Labs did was to say, we don't take this as a given. And what's happening now is because these former drug dealers and others are telling their stories of hope and then develop creative solutions around it, creative technologies, creative companies that solve problems. Now, University of Cape Town students come to them to learn about it. And that is, in terms of role modeling, one of the most effective approaches I've seen in terms of at scale, having people both develop a mindset that they can actually solve problems on their own, but also more importantly, it changes the trajectory of what people feel is possible. And then, you know, in collaboration with other organizations that actually then support those efforts, help do something about it. I'll come back to that in a second, but one of the things that of course is really interesting also is the role of technology, because technology in a way accelerates this kind of feeling of what is the potentiality out there, because both we have a certain visibility of potentiality, we see all the potential lives we could live, right? I can see now online how someone in Nicaragua lives their life, and I can try to aspire to, oh, I like this element of it, or I like this element. When I think back to the conversations I've had with my grandparents, they were mostly, you know, they grew up in a village, they lived the whole life in a village. And so if the father did something and worked in XYZ job, usually you as a son would then also go into a similar job, because that is what you know, and that is what you see is possible. Now, when you see different inspiring stories online and around the world, of course you develop a certain different idea of potentiality that is out there, but at the same time also of actual potentiality. So how the internet and other things help us to actually create our own solutions, where you can set up from your basement a new company and all these different types of themes that actually have a potentiality that if we create structures that allow that to really flourish, can do a lot. Now we'll come back to that point in a second. And then as a third trend, so the first trend being that kind of shifts in mindset, the second trend being that kind of technology as a part equalizer, but partly also, of course, reinforcing existing inequalities. I think someone posted the wonderful question around how do we essentially make sure that people who don't have access to the internet, for example, are still part of those kind of efforts. So I think that's you know, an extremely important question. And then, of course, environmental and societal pressures that we see all happening. We also see that societal problems become more and more complex, and of course, disease such as COVID-19. You know, and that's the interesting thing at the moment in terms of, you know, that we feel there's this kind of unprecedented event happening at the moment. This is a graphic that I quite like. It's the unprecedented use of the word unprecedented. So the idea that at the moment, everything that's happening appears to be really unprecedented because it is obviously unprecedented from our perspective. What's interesting, though, of course, when you go into history is that there have a lot of times been unprecedented things, both at the big, you know, higher level in terms of the whole society, pandemics and other questions, but also then, of course, on the individual level, every potential day, there is something that potentially completely changes our life. So that can be potentially unprecedented for us individually. And so in a way, throughout history, civilization has always depended on our ability to make the best out of the unknown. And that is the case again at the moment, of course. I mean, we see very kind of inspiring things coming out of this kind of very unexpected situation. I mean, you know, not that unexpected for some epidemiologists, but more unexpected for others. And, you know, we see inspiring solutions, such as breweries saying, okay, we can use our alcohol to produce alcohol-based hand sanitizers, or rideshare programs for senior citizens becoming emergency services to help those citizens, or insurances, the more kind of, you know, the more values-driven insurances saying, okay, instead of trying to sell people something at the moment, maybe we should just call them up when we know, you know, there's a particular part of the population, maybe those people who live alone, where we might just call them up and have a conversation that has nothing to do with insurance, but in a way we shape some of our employees into heroes against loneliness. So to really make people feel that they are not alone. Or we see on the individual level, individuals reinventing themselves and trying to reorient. And so during all the kind of, you know, intensity that's happening at the moment. I mean, I'm in New York here, so I'm feeling that particularly both with, you know, parents or friends dying, a lot of grief that I myself felt and others felt. So there's of course the baseline of there's something that is extremely unprecedented in our lifetimes happening, and that is really kind of dragging down. And at the same time, there is people who are trying to see what in that situation can be done to at least in a way turn that into something that we can work with in terms of some kind of positive outcomes. And so we see that also leaders are showing their real colors. We see some companies that intuitively kind of flex into directly laying people off. And we're seeing others who try to find creative solutions. For example, who might say, okay, we have some cash reserves here. So instead of firing people, what we do is we will keep you on the staff, but we will add that as overtime for some later point, or whatever the kind of solutions are, but just something that allows for people to not be dismissed. And we see very different types of leadership styles emerging. And that's actually something throughout kind of different crises we've observed. So for example, Best Buy after the Hurricane Maria, in Puerto Rico, something they did is, so the hurricane happened and they have a couple of retail shops there, and you know, their employees were extremely affected. And so the first thing Best Buy did was to say, let's fly over private planes, let those people fly out who want to fly out, and essentially kind of enable people, local communities and others to somehow survive this in a very dignified way. And so they had investor calls afterwards, and investors asked them, why would you do this? Like, this costs a lot of money, and, you know, does it really pay off? And the leadership at that point said, you know what, like, this is based on, if we have values that are related to family and other themes, this is what we're supposed to do. It's the right thing to do. And based on the right thing that they tried to do, in the long run, actually, what happened was they had a much higher employee productivity because people felt you know, that is a company that I can really trust and that it has my back, but also, of course, much higher customer loyalty. And so what happened here is that in a way, obviously, during crisis, we look particularly at what do leaders do, and that might shape their legitimacy for the years to come. And then, of course, what becomes really important, and that is really the focus of my work, is developing a muscle for the unexpected. Because the unexpected, as we'll talk about in a second, happens all the time, if we see it or not. And it's something I've been finding extremely fascinating. I want to give you a couple of examples of how the unexpected happens all the time, and particularly how that kind of unexpectedness can lead to positive outcomes if we are proactively doing something about it. This here is an example of there's a practice in organizations. It doesn't have the most fortunate name, but for the lack of, you know, having a better name at this point, it's a post-mortem exercise. And so the idea is, if a project doesn't work out in a company, then it gets laid to rest in front of other people within the organization. So let's say, for example, you know, one example in the company was a window frame. And so they had this window glass that wouldn't reflect light. And, you know, it's a wonderful technology, but they didn't realize that there is no real, like, nobody really would want to pay for that. Like, it's just, it's too much money for just having light not being reflected. And so they were, okay, we have to, you know, forget about it. Usually in an organization, what you would do is you would try to, quote unquote, hide the mistake, right? Or you would try to hide the failure that just happened. In that company, they do the opposite. They don't celebrate failure, but they celebrate the learning from failure. So what they do is they ask people to go on stage in front of other project managers, present what they learned from what didn't work out and what their takeaways are. And so they talked about this technology and they said, look, we did this window glass and we underestimated that nobody would buy it. And then someone in the audience is like, hey, have you considered what this would mean for solar? Because if you think about in solar, it's all about absorbing sunlight and kind of transforming it into energy. And so essentially that could be wonderful, couldn't it? And that is how part of their solar division emerged. When they look back now, they would say, oh, that was lucky that it happened. It was just a coincidence that that person sat in the room. Yeah, that's true. But you know, it was slightly facilitated by having a practice internally that allowed people A, to put something out there, but also B, to actually connect the dots. I'll come back to that in a second, but the core idea really being it allowed people to essentially have serendipity happen. This is another example. It's an example in history a couple of decades ago, where a couple of researchers were injecting some medication, trying to cure angina, and they were injecting it, and they realized that in the trousers of men, of the male participants, there was some kind of movement happening. And so, you know, they got like curious, like, what is happening with this? Like, why do men get an erection when this happens? And the normal reaction, of course, would be either try to ignore it or to find a quote unquote better medication that doesn't have the quote unquote side effects of having, you know, people's trousers move. They did exactly the opposite. They said, wow, this is unexpected. But you know what? We know that a lot of men in the world might have that problem. And so why don't we try to create a product based on this that actually helps people have those kind of moments happen? And that is how Viagra evolved, right? Viagra was quote unquote complete serendipity, but actually it was facilitated by people who saw the unexpected and connected the dots. Now, this is an example, one of my favorites at the moment, of a company that I've been working with in China. Called Hire, and they do a lot of kind of things related to household items. So they do washing machines, refrigerators, those kind of things. And essentially, they got a lot of calls from farmers. And the farmers told them, well, you know, I try to wash my potatoes in the washing machine, but somehow it doesn't work. It always breaks down. So what would we usually do if we were the company? We would say, well, man, don't, or woman, don't wash your potatoes in the washing machine. Like, you know, the washing machine is there for clothes to be washed. They said, well, you know, this is unexpected, but you know what? We know that there's a lot of farmers in China. So why don't we build in a dirt filter and essentially then make it a potato washing machine? So what you're seeing here now is a potato washing machine that is part of their assortment as essentially saying, okay, maybe there's a solution. And the fourth example, it's an example that happened in London a couple of years ago, where a friend of mine called me up in the morning. He wasn't a friend back then, he's a good friend now, Nathaniel. And he called me up and he said, well, Christian, so that was during that period when that kind of volcano broke out in Iceland with an unpronounceable name. I'm not even trying to pronounce it, E and then 14 letters after it. But that volcano broke out. And a lot of people were stuck in London, and there was this kind of Skull World Forum, so the biggest forum for social entrepreneurs in the world, and they were all stuck in London. They couldn't get back to wherever they came from. And so Nathaniel called up and he said, Christian, all these amazing people are stuck in London, so I want to organize a conference. Within 30 hours, he organized a full-fledged TEDx conference with 10,000 people on the recorded live stream, fantastic speakers, and so on. What he did was he saw that unexpected moment that everyone had, right? Everyone had a volcano that broke out and everyone was stuck in London. But he essentially said, well, I know that TED loves kind of turning uncertainty into opportunity. So why don't I make a narrative out of this, pitch it to them, and then bring in other people to make it happen. And so with actually no resources and having almost no contacts in London, but building an interesting momentum around it, he created an event that that was one of the most successful ones out there. The point here is all of these four examples are examples where something unexpected happened and then someone did something about it. And when mapping ideas over the last years and looking at how different ideas within companies and more broadly different ideas emerge, one of the things that I've been fascinated by is that in a way we see very clearly how those people who have a lot of serendipity happen versus those that don't have very clear patterns that differentiate them, and the same with companies where it happens all the time. So that's kind of really where serendipity comes into play, as this kind of unexpected good luck that results from kind of these unplanned, unexpected moments, but it's essentially where these kind of proactive decisions lead us to positive outcomes. So what does this mean? It means that it's not just an event, it's not just something like that happens to us. There is something unexpected happening, right? There's some kind of serendipity trigger, but then actually we have to do something about it. We have to connect the dots. We have to proactively make a decision about something and then have the tenacity to follow up with it. And that's the beauty of essentially then saying, hey, serendipity, we can influence because we can both try to have more serendipity triggers in our life, but we also can try to connect the dots differently, and we can train our minds, we can develop communities, we can develop organizations that allow for connecting the dots much more, like in the example earlier with the post-mortem. And the interesting thing, of course, is that most times in life, we miss serendipity all the time, right? We can miss serendipity if we don't see the unexpected. So in the case of Viagra, for example, if we don't see it, or if we don't connect the dots, so if we don't see, oh, this unexpected thing relates to something different that I wasn't even searching for. That is an interesting positive outcome that this could become a medication, but hey, what does this actually mean? And then of course, if we don't have the tenacity to do it, then it doesn't work either. There's a lot of examples in research and in history of counterfactuals, right? So in a way, counterfactuals are obviously a good way to say what could have happened and what could have happened differently if we would have decided differently. And that's of course particularly interesting in terms of serendipity, because serendipity, we obviously a lot of times need to, or more usually we have to make sense out of at hindsight. And I'll talk about this a bit more later. But if you look at something, for example, in the example of Papain, which essentially you had two researchers a couple of years ago or a couple of decades ago working on it. They injected that into rabbits actually. And rabbits essentially, their ears flopped. Whenever they put that in, the ears flopped of the rabbits. And you know, both of them saw it. So both of them saw the kind of serendipity trigger, but only one of them actually really followed through on it. The other one was too busy with other things. One of them ended up working in the lab. The other one ended up getting a Nobel Prize for it. The point is that both of them had potential serendipity happen. The unexpected happened. There was a trigger. but only one of them properly connected the dots and helped now, you know, cure things like arthritis and other things that were related to that particular protein. The interesting thing also is, if we think more broadly about kind of the question of that part of serendipity that is about, in a way, seeing the world and being alert to the unexpected, and then somehow also believing that we can create our own luck. There's very interesting social experiments. One, for example, done by Richard Wiseman, who's in the UK. He did an experiment where he took people who self-identify as extremely lucky, and then people who self-identify as extremely unlucky. And so one person who self-identifies as extremely lucky, they told him, okay, walk down the street, go into a coffee shop, order a coffee, and sit down next to the counter. That's it. Nothing more you have to do. Just walk down the street, go into the coffee shop, sit down, have your coffee. What they didn't tell him is, okay, there's hidden cameras across the street. There's a 5-pound note in front of the entrance. And then at the table closest to the counter is this successful businessman who can make big dreams happen. Now, there's also a person who self-identifies as extremely unlucky, and they tell her to do this the exactly same thing. Now, what happens is the lucky person walks down the street, sees the 5-pound note, picks it up, goes inside, orders a coffee, has a nice conversation with the barista, sits down next to the businessman, makes a friend. We don't know if there's an opportunity coming out of it, but it wouldn't be unexpected. Then the unlucky person walks down the street, steps over the 5-pound note, goes inside, orders the coffee, also sits next to the businessman, ignores the businessman, and that's it. Now, at the end of the day, they asked both people, so how was your day? And you know, the lucky person said, or the self-identified lucky person says, well, it was amazing. I found money in the streets, I made new friends, and you know, we don't know if an opportunity came out of it, but maybe even more stuff came out of it. The unlucky person just said, well, nothing really happened. And that is something I've been really fascinated by, like when you look at different types of experiments and different types of research around organizations, how they facilitate that. That idea that serendipity, and in this case, the part that really focuses on seeing the unexpected, a lot of times really depends on that kind of alertness and that idea of it is possible to actually have it. There's also other experiments, of course, you know, around, for example, how a lot of times we miss quote unquote lucky things because we might be in a kind of focused mode, right? Some kind of functional fixedness. So, for example, experiments that are around letting people, like the brief would be read through a newspaper very quickly and tell us how many things you're seeing of XYZ item. And people focus on that, of course, but then it also says, hey, like a big line, if you see this, you get $100, stop the experiment and go back to the interviewer and say you saw that. And people don't see it because they're so focused on essentially just identifying what they were told to identify. And I will come back to that in a second when talking about how quote unquote functional fixedness really completely limits our potential opportunity space for serendipity, because it lets us only think through solutions within a very narrow space. And within that space, it's very hard to connect dots because the most interesting things are usually out of that box. And so I'll come back to that in a second. One consideration, of course, that we thought a lot around is how different the base levels of serendipity are, right? If you are a kid that grows up in a council estate in London, you certainly don't have an environment where serendipity happens to the degree as it happens when you grow up with all the networks in the world and the kind of self-confidence that was instilled in you as a young kid, and you go after school, you go back to dinner and you reflect on what you learned in class, right? These kind of things are very different across social strata. So there's of course a huge difference in terms of the serendipity base level that happens, especially in contexts like with the example I mentioned earlier with reconstructed living labs. Now, the interesting thing of course is that there's a lot of biases that hold us back from serendipity. For example, we tend to underestimate the unexpected, even though 50% of success in a lot of areas is quote unquote unexplained variance. So it's just something unexpected and then somehow we got successful, but then we still might pretend, you know, we had it all mapped out. I'll talk about this in a second. But there's those of you interested, and you might actually have come across this probably, the birthday paradox, for example, that already in a room of 23 people, there's a 50% probability that two people have the same birthday. In a room of 23 people, a 50% probability that there's at least one pair of people who have the same birthday. The point here is that there's so many potential pairs, right? Everyone in that room could have so many different potential pairs with other people, or so many other links with other people. So you have so many different potential pairs of people that it's not a linear, but an exponential question. And that is one of the interesting things that, of course, life in a similar way, and I'm not using the kind of statistical appropriate terms, but life in a similar way is exponential, right? There's so many unexpected things out there. And just because we're so used to a very linear way of thinking, we actually think it's more probable that our plan works out. But actually, a lot of times, it might be more probable that something of all the potential unexpected potentialities happens out there. There's, of course, a couple of other things like self-centering. We try to sometimes limit ideas because we might feel, you know, like an imposter. We might feel there's different types of ways of why we keep and hold ourselves back and also others. And again, I'm keeping this very short because I know you're the specialists in those kind of questions. So I will certainly not try to go into an area that I feel you probably have much more and deeper knowledge. And again, I'd love to dive into that at some point individually with you as well. But I've been fascinated by things such as how, of course, we always try to find meaning in random patterns, right? So the man in the moon, or Virgin Mary and cheese sandwiches, or you know, this pigeon example where they dropped kind of food for pigeons, and then essentially the pigeon always assumed that whatever it did before it got the food would be why it got the food. And so it would just do the same movement again, but actually the food was dropping completely random. And so even pigeons try to see some kind of meaning in something that might be completely random. And so in a way, we always have this kind of longing for predictability, for patterns, even though a lot of times the patterns, you know, might just be constructed by ourselves because we hope that they might be there, even though they might not be there. We have functional fixes. And then, of course, my favorite, post-rationalization. So this idea that, you know, when we have something like talking about our job or something else, we tend to tell a very linear story, right? I planned this, then I planned this, and I planned this. But actually, a lot of times, you know, yes, we plan it this way, but then the actual experience is more like a whole squibble, and then we tell the official story. And there's, of course, a lot of reasons why we do this, including that as leaders, for example, we want to portray a sense of control, or we might want to portray that we have, you know, the competence. But of course, a lot of times that then doesn't really let us learn from hero stories or so, because they are not the real story that are happening. Now, with all these biases, one of the key things, of course, now is how do we actually cultivate serendipity? How do we learn to spot the unexpected and connect the dots? I put this in here and we discussed earlier, I'm very happy to share the presentation. You know, I try to today kind of bring what usually would be a whole day seminar into essentially 50 minutes. And so unfortunately we can't dive too deep into it, but we will make sure to share the presentation with you. And I included those slides that will follow that we can't dive deeper into, but just for you to focus on those that you might hopefully feel inspired by. So one way that kind of helps us cultivate serendipity that's very tactical is, of course, the way we ask questions, right? Is it, what do you do? Which is like kind of putting people into boxes versus what is on your mind? And again, you are experts in asking questions, so I will not endeavor to dive into that. But one of the tactical things that I found fascinating there is the idea of setting hooks. So, for example, there's an entrepreneur in London. When he gets asked, what do you do? He answers something like, well, I've been working in education, but I've recently been exploring XYZ philosophy. But what I'm really excited about is XYZ paintings, or whatever the kind of three things are that he finds are really relevant. And so now what he does is he puts three potential serendipity triggers out there, where someone that hears the answer could be like, oh my God, such a coincidence. I also recently discovered a passion for painting, or I also recently got into philosophy, or XYZ. The point here is, by putting more dots out there, we make it more likely that there's some kind of potential unexpected overlap. Now, of course, we talked about looking at mistakes or crises differently, like in the examples of Viagra and others. Of course, we can redefine situations. So for example, there's ways in organizations where with regard to budgets, one organization, for example, when someone comes with a budget, what they say is, okay, great that you have this budget, but it always has to answer three questions. First question, is this item really needed? Second question, is there something else that you could use instead of that item that doesn't cost us anything? So is there an old garage we could use as a training center? Is there a friend of yours that could come in as a trainer that charges like one third of the price? Is there something that you personally can do that you haven't seen as a talent yet, but that might be a talent in that context and you could do it yourself? Those kind of questions that help people to think about situations differently, not from a resourcing perspective, but from a perspective of what is the actual problem here and how can I solve it in a way that actually brings in my own talents that are already there or the resources that are already there. So that's where bricolage and other themes come into play that we've been working on a lot in terms of how do you make the best out of what is at hand and how do you realize that that might already be there in you or with organizations. Enabling serendipity spotting. So there's different approaches, such as one of the ones that I find interesting, you know, in times of self-isolation or quarantine is, for example, serendipity bombs. So the idea that in a way, identifying the 5 to 10 people that I respect the most, but I haven't been in touch yet, but I could potentially via LinkedIn send them an email, you know, this function where you can find people or you can contact every person via email that is on LinkedIn. And essentially by doing this, you can send them an honest email and say something like, okay, well, I've been inspired by the work and XYZ is what I'm excited about at the moment. And what I found fascinating is we did a couple of these tests with people who sent emails to people they respect a lot and they never felt they could really approach them. And because people at the moment are both extremely busy, but also somehow in a way look at everything a bit more because they, you know, like virtual is the only thing. So you do look at all emails and everything else. And so essentially there's a lot of answers coming back like, oh my God, interesting that you've been working on this. I was thinking about exploring a similar area. Let's do something together. In a time where everyone is trying to figure it out, there's so much ambiguity that a lot of people actually might unexpectedly be interested in something that isn't on our radar. And again, this is not about like cheap business development type approaches, but this is about like genuine, honest like approaches of saying, I've been inspired by you. This is what I'm working on. If there's any kind of things that we could ever explore, like please let me know. And that's how a lot of times those kind of people can connect the dots for us rather than the other way around. We've done something similar with people in low-income contexts where, so for example, I've been doing a lot of work with kids in the council flats in London. And one thing, of course, there is when you come out of prison, there's not a lot of opportunities you have at this point, right? And in terms of your CV or in terms of the networks you have and so on. And so one kind of small like serendipity bomb approach we've been doing with them is to say, okay, go to a public event. When you're at this public event, and there's whoever the speaker is, doesn't matter, but there's always 200, 300, 400 people. Always ask the first question. So stand up kind of dynamically so that people actually realize, oh, there's someone who wants to ask a question. Of course, not overdoing it. And then asking the question. So for example, with this one gentleman I worked with, he would ask the question, you know, in a way of saying, I was really inspired by what you just said. So focusing on the speaker. And then as someone who just went through XYZ experience, I was really inspired by what you just said. And of course, only sharing what they feel comfortable with sharing and not oversharing and everything else and keeping it really short. But the point here is that now what usually happens in almost all the experiences that I've been involved with is that they raise the question in a very kind of genuine way. And then there's after the session, always 5-6 people out of the audience coming to them saying, oh my God, such a coincidence. My brother went through a similar situation. Oh my God, such a coincidence. XYZ organization that I'm involved in has been working on this. I would love to put you in touch. The point here is that even if I didn't have any social capital, what I just did is I created an audience of 200 people that in a way can do something out of it. Same, of course, with virtual events at the moment. You know, there's a lot of events, of course, where at the moment you can ask, or we can ask questions online and so on. So it's interesting how we can set our own kind of serendipity bomb, and then other people can connect the dots for us. And again, we can't even know that that could be a potentiality. In his case, for example, one of them, the gentleman I mentioned, got his next job out of it because someone said, look, you're the kind of person I want to work with, because that is a kind of inspirational story. Yeah. Then, of course, we can leverage technology and space design. There's a lot of examples how to do this, or random coffee trials. So randomly pairing up people within organizations and then having at the moment a virtual lunch together and just, you know, seeing where it goes without a lot of pressure, maybe a couple of inspiring questions that, that they can ask each other. And if we give them an excuse as organization, they don't feel awkward about it because we could just say, hey, look, these are the questions and, you know, feel free to talk about those. And that's kind of where then that diversity happens. That's important for serendipity. And then, of course, most importantly, that question of how do we develop a North Star or something to connect the dots to. So if you are an organization like MasterCard, for example, if you have a vision of lifting 500 million people into the financial system, or as a Danone of eradicating malnutrition, it's easier than to, if I bump into someone as an employee, I can say, oh my God, such a coincidence that relates to our North Star, or that relates to my personal North Star in terms of my own curiosity, or whatever it is. So the point being, like defining a certain frame that gives us a certain sense of direction, being that a North Star or else, but then appreciating how often the unexpected plays a role. And there was a wonderful question in the document that I received about, especially with those people who feel they have to plan, how do you then, like, what is the planning approaches you can use? And one of the things that I've been really fascinated by is exactly that idea of having an approximate North Star and defining some kind of ideas of similar to how you would do a business plan of saying, you know, these are the kind of steps we can do. But then essentially saying, you know what, the North Star is what we aspire to. These steps is what we want to do, but please be open that this might change. And then building that appreciation of the unexpected into it. It's almost in a way what Governor Cuomo here in New York is trying to do at the moment. He's saying, look, my vision for this, or my idea for this, or my hope for this is that we get out of this with health, public health okay, and with the economy okay. So he sets a certain parameter based on certain values or whatever the kind of parameters are. But then he also says, I don't know yet when exactly that will be. I don't know yet how exactly that will play out. That doesn't mean that he doesn't give us a plan, right? He still gives us a roadmap. He says on the 15th, we will try to do this. We will do this. We will do this. But again, he doesn't say this is in stone. And by not saying that's in stone, he keeps his credibility. But more importantly, he keeps the trust that people have in him, because he can say, look, I gave you my vision. I gave you an approximation of my plan. But I also told you that the plan appreciates the unexpected, and we will react to new information. And that, in a way, you know, if intelligence is about the ability to react to new information, that, of course, is an intelligent approach. Other approaches that I've seen work out and that kind of came out in some of our research are, for example, using curiosity and other approaches to really as a driving force for us. Now, a couple of final thoughts that try to integrate some more of your questions. One is smart luck versus blind luck, which is, of course, in that idea, serendipity is smart luck. It's a process we can influence. Blind luck is something like an inheritance we get, or just something we didn't influence, we didn't work for. And so serendipity is really about the kind of activeness of it. Then, of course, synchronicity versus serendipity. I can imagine, you know, Carl Jung and others being really on everyone's mind. And so what I've always found fascinating about synchronicity is that, of course, if you see it as a kind of meaningful coincidence or something that is like an event that happens and, you know, it can unfold in different ways. Like, I mean, I remember the example he had where he was with a patient, and then there's this kind of that she had in her dreams, and so far he wasn't able to somehow get through to her because she's a very rational person who wants to not believe that the unexpected or the irrational can happen. And then essentially there is a kind of animal knocking on his what is it, like an insect that is tapping on his window at some point, and it looks like, or it has the colors of a scarab. And at that moment when she sees it the day after she dreamt about those colors, she is now convinced that unpredictable things can happen. That that of course is an extremely kind of unexpected synchronous event. And there's of course a lot of different types of other synchronous events that can happen. The interesting thing I feel in general is that there seem to be a lot of overlaps between those kind of concepts in terms of the unexpectedness and in terms of the unpredictableness of it. But then also in terms of synchronicity, the way we've been looking at it is similar to a serendipity, that in a way we can explain it a little bit by a probability. We can say it is very probable that during, you know, if you have like 50 sessions with a with someone like this who might be completely focused on a particular plan, that at some point something unexpected happens, right? That like someone comes into a room, does something completely unexpected, and she just dreamt about something that might be related to it. Yes, that happens, right? But again, it can certainly be explained why it happens as an event. And again, you're the experts on that end in terms of synchronicity in itself. What I find fascinating about serendipity is really that kind of once we see it as a process of seeing and connecting dots, and really that tenacity of turning that into positive outcomes, again, that overlaps partly with the more active approaches in synchronicity. But usually the way I try to make sense out of it is synchronicity more as an event that happens and serendipity more as a process that we influence over time, and in a way we work for it to happen. Of course, also a couple of other things, a lot of questions were around imperfection and perfectionism. So there's, of course, a lot of value in normalizing imperfection. There's a lot of practices in organizations. For example, people, leaders saying, hey, look, at the beginning, all ideas here are bad, so put your idea out there, that's okay. Or, you know, others highlighting imperfect solutions just to say, look, this is normal. A paper at the beginning always turns out than a paper different than a paper after. And so really normalizing the idea that nobody's perfect. Of course, there's energetic elements like meditation, entropy, the idea that we have to be in motion for something to happen in physics, personality traits, of course. So the idea that if I'm more extroverted, I'm meeting more people, I'm attracting more people, potentially, I'm potentially keeping in touch with more people, but also then introspection being really important because serendipity unfolding, being unfolding over time. So that being really important. And then quite a few of you talked about or wondered about social capital and social networks and really thinking about that. I've been really excited about the question of how do we how do we try to understand our hidden social capital? So if we have a local rabbi or a local priest or a local teacher, like what is their kind of, what is the potentiality there in terms of who they might know and how we could map those multipliers, but also how easily we can at the moment, especially join interest-based communities like meetup.com and others to really be part of those kind of communities online based on our respective interests, meet new people, but also deepen relationships with people who we can invite to it and like cook together virtually and all these different things where we can really deepen relationships with people. But also at the moment, the great opportunity to be on a collective journey together because we have so similar experiences. So to wrap the final thoughts up, the happy ending, of course, depends on when we look at it, from whose perspective we look at it, and what we define as positive outcome and success. When you look at a breakup in the moment, it looks like really bad, right? But then when I look at most of my breakups in my life, I look back and I'm like, okay, well, you know, it put us on different trajectories that might, you know, that led us to living a pretty okay life, and we learn from it. And so essentially that idea of how we define positive outcome or success obviously changes over time. So again, the definition then changes based on when we look at it, and what might be bad luck one day might turn into serendipity the other day. There's of course a lot around language and so on. So I included a couple of points here for you to go through around intuition as well, and how our education system is failing. But I want to focus on, or I want to finish with, you know, coming from Heidelberg, I want to finish on a philosophical thought. We have this philosopher's way in Heidelberg, where Goethe and Schiller wrote their poems and so. And so I've always been very inspired by Goethe. And Goethe, in a way, inspired Viktor Frankl, because when Viktor Frankl, who I'm sure you have been very familiar with, when he was during the difficult periods where he was in the concentration camp and tried to understand how can I find meaning during this period, and then he got out of it and he told the story of the flight instructor that I really enjoyed, which was around this idea that the flight instructor told him, Victor, if you want to fly like this, you have to start like this because the wind will pull you down. So if you start as a realist, you end up as a depressionist. But if you start as an optimist, you end up as the real realist. And that's actually what Goethe said hundreds of years ago. He said that if you take someone as they are, you make them worse. But if you take them as who they could be, you make them capable of becoming what you can be. And that is actually what a lot of our work is showing, that in a way, once people realize the potentiality and that they could become different people, they could be different people, they could reinvent themselves, and that it doesn't really matter if a plan works out exactly the way or it doesn't, that gives people, and especially my students, for example, also that kind of drive to say, okay, I'm okay to wing it at times. I'm okay to not have it figured all out because I am becoming someone at the moment. I'm not a fixed person. I'm not a fixed kind of mindset or so on. And so that is really the kind of key essence of everything I talked about, this idea of that I feel our role and particularly my role is well-being. How do we develop platform structures for people where they can become their best selves? And my editor tells me to finish on that slide, you know, to mention that there is a book coming out that will cover a lot of these areas. And I'm super open. I mean, I know that unfortunately in the room, you know, where we had so many wonderful people, unfortunately we can't do like a person-to-person Q&A. I hope I integrated some of the questions already and Jess might have others, but please do feel free to send them over. Also your feedback, your advice, you know, constantly learning. I mean, I'm also very, very well aware that I'm also figuring it out. And so if you feel there were areas where, hey, XYZ could be different or could be improved, please do feel free to reach out anytime. This is my email and this is my Twitter account. Thank you so much. And it was a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you so much, Christian. And I have to congratulate you on basically breaking GoToWebinar. We had so much interest that after 1,001 people, we had to start turning people away. So they will get the recording. I want to thank you so much as a proud serendipitor. I acknowledge that my greatest blessings and liabilities come from my tendency to want to seek meaning in every pattern and every trend and every random occurrence. So this has been so wonderful. I encourage everyone to reach out to buy the book. And thank you again for helping us to understand how to transform these crazy times into opportunity.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye, all.
Goodbye, everyone.